Let me read for you a portion of scripture. We will read a couple of verses in the book of Acts and chapter 4. Allow me to read it in portions. We will begin reading verse 1 to verse 4, and then we will pick it up again in verse 13, and then we will finish as we read verse 23 and just a couple of other verses in there. Let me ask that you stand on your feet as we read God's word. And so we begin with verse 1, Acts chapter 4 and verse 1. We read up to verse 4. The priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed, and the number of the men grew to about 5,000. Verse 13, when they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. Amen. Let me read that verse again. When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. Verse 23, on their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said, you made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David, who said, why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers gather together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel in this city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with a great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and to perform miraculous signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. Verse 31, after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God boldly. Father, we ask that this reading of your word will do exactly what it did to the people of old, and that it will open our minds and our spirits, our hearts, and we will come to the same grips of understanding of who you are and what you are able to do, so that we can release ourselves by faith into your hands. We thank you, Lord, for the possibility of hearing your word. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. What I want you to note is that when these men, Peter and John, gave a report to the people, and the genesis of the story is in chapter 3. They are walking, Peter and John are walking into the temple, and they find a beggar. He's been begging. He was lame. He was incapacitated that way, and he was sitting there and begging. Peter and John say, "We don't have silver and gold, but we do have something that we are going to give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you stand up and walk." And he stands, and of course the service, I don't know what kind of service was going on, but there was a service in the temple, and he stands up and he walks through the aisle. And the Bible says he was jumping and shouting, and he was praising God. And I don't know what you would do if I'm in the middle of my sermon here and somebody walks in. This is a person you know. They've been sitting at the gate there, and then he stands up and he comes walking, jumping. The first thing you don't expect that is that he should be jumping. Not only that, but he was also shouting. He was praising God for the kind of things that had happened. And so he walks in, disrupts the service, and that annoys the leaders. And I don't know why leaders tend to be annoyed by good things. And that's maybe a discussion for another time. But that happened, and it keeps happening. Good things, and especially when the good things are not done by the people that you expected. I think that's where the problem of leadership comes from. And we just came over from a global leadership summit, and I'm not about to go into that. But so these people were arrested, and they were put in jail, and all kinds of things happened while they were there. And finally, under the pressure of the people and also the clarity of their expression, they were released. When they were released, they came back to the church, to their own people. And the Bible says that they gave a report, and after the report, when the people heard their report, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Say with me, they raised their voices to God. This is something that I am learning, and I want to continue to learn, that when things are bad, when there are challenges in my life, when things are going muhama, kikiumana, like they say, you are to lift your voice to God. Say again, lift your voice to God. We need to come to a place as believers where we know we have a God who listens to us, and we are to lift our voice to God. I wish that there were more Americans here than our brother Bob and Alan and Judy, because that's what I would tell them. Instead of going to the streets like we did, now, of course, Americans cannot tell us that we shouldn't go to the streets, because they did go to the streets also. But that's not the thing to do. When things happen that you did not expect, you lift your voice to God. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Okay. You said amen. I hope you believe it, because I asked you to say amen. But can you say amen if you believe it?
Amen.
Amen. So things go bad, you call on God. Things go bad between you and your wife. Things go between you and your husband, not so sweet. Between you and your son. Between you and your daughter. Between you and your father-in-law. Between you and your cows and your goats. Whatever the situation is, raise your voice to God. Believers, let us learn how to raise our voices to God. Amen. You should read what our brother Dongler, Steve Dongler, says to the young people. There's a little plaque he has written, and he says, don't raise your voice. And how many of us think that raising our voices to people, they are hearing? The louder you speak, the lesser I am hearing. Did you know that? Hello? And he says, don't raise your voice. He says, it's not thunder that waters the ground. It is rain. Raise your voice, but to God. Now, I want you to note something else, and this is going to be shorter than normal. I don't usually speak short messages by design. I want you to note that they recognized the sovereignty of God. They said, Sovereign Lord, look at what these people are doing. They don't understand you. They don't understand you created the heavens and the earth. They don't understand that everything that is in this earth belongs to you. Look at these people. They don't understand you. They came to a recognition of the God that they serve. And they said, you are the sovereign Lord. And I think that believers need to come to grips with the kind of God that they believe in. So that when you sing, you are not only singing, but you are also believing. Wewe ni Mungu mkuu, waweza yote, hakuna Mungu kama wewe. Sing it again. Wewe ni Mungu mkuu, waweza yote, hakuna Mungu kama wewe. They understood. Wewe ni Mungu mkuu. There is no God like you. We serve a big God. And once you come to that realization, when you hear 20 million, you will realize that that is the 10% of 200. Hello? And you know, we've come from afar. We were talking 200. Now we are talking 20. You will be able to say, wewe ni Mungu mkuu. Tulianza na 200, sasa tunazungumza 20. Isn't God good? Amen? So these people, they recognized, you are the sovereign Lord. Now that word is an English word, but the theologians have taken that word and made it, turned it into a theological jargon. Yes, it is an English word. But what it means is that for someone to be sovereign, it means that person has authority over everything that is under him. That person is sovereign. When we talk about we are a sovereign state, that means things happening in Ethiopia or Somalia up north and Uganda or Tanzania, those things don't as much concern us. We do not give authoritative statements. We only give statements concerning our country. President Uhuru doesn't go to Uganda and begin to tell them, nyinyi mukicheza. If there is corruption, and there surely is corruption in Uganda, he doesn't go to Uganda and say, we will arrest you. But he talks to Kenya and says, I will arrest you. And you know about hate speakers. Hello? Were they arrested? Yes, they were arrested. Na wakakula ugali in Pangani. Because we have a sovereign leader. He says, I will arrest you. Don't go around it. Arrest me, uone. You will be arrested. And na ataona, wewe ndio utaona, because you are the one who is arrested.
Have you ever had these people who go around on the road? Ebu nigonge uone. You are going around on the nigonge uone. Nitakugonga, pengine nitaona, lakini nani ataona zaidi?
We have a sovereign state. But beyond that, we have a sovereign Lord who is over the entire earth. He controls the air. I was saying to a group of people not too long ago, you know, when the children of Israel, the spies, when they came back, and then there was commotion, and they said, we saw giants, and you know, that land, we can't go and get it. And then they got God so angry, he said, the 40 days that you wasted, I am turning every day to a year. You will be here 40 years, mark the words, so that you may understand what it is to have me against you. Let me tell you, you can be against Uhuru, you can be against the government, you can be, that's okay. They live their own life because they don't cultivate your shamba. But let me tell you, never have God to be against you, because he controls the water. He controls the air. And not only does he control the water and the air, he controls your heartbeat. Anaweza kuzima hiyo oxygen. He controls the sunlight. Never have him against you. He's a sovereign Lord. Tell your neighbor, he is sovereign. Tell them with a bass, he is sovereign. That's right. God is sovereign. He is a sovereign God. And these people recognize that. But they also used scripture, because you see, they said, you spoke through the mouth of your servant in verse 25. And this is what you said. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth, they were using scripture. They remembered what God had said. They used scripture. We, this year, are determined that we will go back to the basics, because going back to the basics means we begin with the scriptures. You remember the book of Acts in chapter 2, just a little earlier, when we talked about the four things that the people of God dwelt in. They dwelt first in the teachings of the apostles, and then they dwelt together as they broke the bread together. They dwelt together in fellowship. They dwelt together in prayer. But they lived, they consumed the teachings of the apostles. So they used scripture. Now, I want to quickly look at the results of their prayer. And we find that in verse 31. These are the results. In verse 31, it says, after they prayed. After they prayed. Tell your neighbor for me, after. Tell them in Kiswahili if they understand. Mwambie baadaye. Yes, it. Si kabla, baadaye. You know, there are things that we expect, but we expect them before. Hello? And I have discovered that many of us, including myself as Christians, that we expect before. We expect the results before. And we come and we complain before. Well, these people, it was after. After they prayed. After you have prayed, now you can actually present your case. And you can ask God, Lord, I prayed. Do you need for me to pray more? Because I have prayed. Look at what happened. After they prayed, there were two things that happened. And I'm bringing this to a close. The first thing is that the place where they were meeting, that place was shaken. It was shaken. And I was trying to explain this in the first service, and I was saying that, you know, this shaking,
You don't understand shaking until either you are shaken or the place where you are is shaken. There was an earthquake that came through not too long ago. How many of you remember that earthquake not too long ago? And I don't know what earthquake is. My brother, one of my brothers, he runs the weather stations in Namibia, and he's a scientist. My mind is theological and only scientific when I enter into some theological stuff that have got some science in them. But my brother's mind is scientific all through, only enters theological when there are some theological stuff in the scientific. Now, do you get that? Okay, now we will. So, unless you are shaken like the earthquake, that's when you understand. There's a friend of mine who was saying that now some people don't beat their wives, but they shake them. Now you should understand this. They don't beat their wives, but they shake them. And what they do is they are angry with their wives, and they grab this woman, and you say, you know, if I was not saved, and by that time you are really being shaken and squeezed. Kama mimi singa kuwa nimeokoka, ninge. And the wife is she's being shaken. Now that's a different shaking, because the earth may not be shaking, and unless the shaking was really traumatic, but imagine the place being shaken, and shame on you who shake your wives. We can talk about that later. She was taken on the side to be a companion, the rib near the heart to be loved. God could have chosen to take that bone from anywhere. He's the creator, isn't he? He could have taken it from the feet so that you'd be walking on her. But he decided no. He could have taken it from the head so that she becomes a headache. But he took it from the side. That's another topic for another day. The place was shaken. Why? I think what happened is the presence of God. The presence of God came. And so say to your neighbor, the presence. There was one day I was riding in Kenya Bus. How many of you remember Kenya Bus? KBS. They say KBS. That the famous Kenya Bus that took us through the city. There were no other buses. There were matatus. And I remember some of those buses were old. They were old. And they had interesting, I'm only not wanting to call them funny, but they were interesting noises. When the engine started, the whole bus, even where you're sitting, you get massage for free sitting in the bus, you know. And I remember entering into this bus, and I think this big mouse, a big rat, I mean, I think it was hiding there for the night, and it forgot to climb down when the bus got started. So somehow I think it moved from the warmer places and it hid somewhere in the body. But as the bus continued to move, this particular bus was really shaking. And I think the rat felt, you know, even where I'm hiding, this is not safe. So it came out and you could see, you know, people's legs going up, particularly ladies. You know, ladies don't like rats, not at all. And I better finish that story even now. That is what it is when the place is being shaken. Everything is brought out. Even the rat cannot hide, for there is no hiding place when the presence of God is present. They say in English, don't use the two words together, but who says I can't use it? That's only the English teacher. When the presence of God is present, there's no hiding place. Tell your neighbor, no hiding place. You know, what I am finding in my life, and I'm asking God to help me, is to move from the hiding place. You know, we are so tricky. We trick one another. We are hiding. We are hiding in our phones. We hide in our minds. We hide in our relationships. We hide. We are hiding from each other. My wife was telling me, and I was saying in the first service that she has interesting stories and interesting experiences. So she tells me, we were treated. I said, why, what were you treated to? She said, today we were treated to this very interesting scenario. The man comes and enters the matatu, and he goes to one side of the matatu, and the wife comes later and goes into this matatu and calls the husband. Did I speak too fast? Now, where was the husband? In the same matatu. And so she begins, sasa kwa nini uliwacha? Well, you left me, and he's in the same matatu. I told you we were going there. Everybody kept quiet because they realized the caller and the recipient were in the same matatu. So everybody was quiet to be treated to this conversation. We hide. I also had another story. I don't know who gave that story to me, but this lady is in a matatu, and somebody receives a call, and he answers a hello. But I told you today I was going to Nyeri. I'm actually near Karatina. So that finishes that story. Another guy is called. Hello. Yeah, but we can't do that tomorrow because I'm on my way to Mombasa. In fact, we just passed a Athi River. Another guy gets another call in the same matatu and says, sorry, Bwana, I'll be only next week because I'm on my way to Kisumu and I am near Nakuru. The lady goes to the driver and says, excuse me, driver, where is this matatu going? You know, I think we need the presence of God in our lives, so that it will wipe away these hiding places. So that you don't hide from your spouse, from your children, from your parents. So that you become transparent. Because when the shaking happens, even those little things, those little mouses, they are shaken out of their hiding place and they have no hiding place. Tell your neighbor again, there's no hiding place. Especially in the presence of God. I look at this prayer and it amazes me of the things that were taking place. And then it says, they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. So the presence of God, and then they were filled. And it says all were filled with the Holy Spirit. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit. I wish and I pray that you and I, we will desire and that we will come to the place where we are filled with the Spirit of God. Because when we are filled with the Spirit of God, of course, God will fill us with his message. He will fill us with his desire. When we are filled with the Spirit of God, it will become easy for us to hear. We will be at the same level with each other. When we talk about finishing this project, we will take shame out of these many years of construction. You will be hearing the same thing if you're filled with the Holy Spirit. And I like I said another time, and praise God, I happen to know a few of you, and I happen to know a few of you from Nairobi and to the village. And I have seen your homes, and I've seen what you have in your homes, and that's your home. And God has given them to you, and thanks to God that God has given you a home. Can you compare that home with this home? Do you know what God said in the book of Haggai? He said, guess what? My house looks like a place of shame, but your houses are beautiful homes. So I have made this decision.
God made the decision. Because you don't want my house to be what it's supposed to be. And I have helped you to understand the relationship between the reason for you having me in your midst and having me far away. This is the decision I have made. You work until the end of the month and you have a salary. Put it in your pocket. I get into the pocket. I don't take your money. I just put holes. Read Haggai. That's what he says. I put holes. Naweka shimo. So the next time you put your hand there, you say, but I put money here. What happened? And he gives a couple of other things. But when you're filled with the Spirit of God, you resonate with God. You resonate with everybody else. And it is not Nzonzi's project. I have a beef with my friends from Central Province, because it doesn't matter how a Mukamba looks like. Could be a big guy, you know. Oh, you guys from Central Province, even a guy who is a principal, you hear them say, Kamuikambagaka. I mean, you know, I say, please increase the K. Hello? So it's not Kamuikambagaka. It is not his project. This is a man who has given energy, time, sleepless nights. What time did you call me last night? He wants to make sure that this thing happens. You're filled with the Holy Spirit. You resonate with those people that are called to do the work of God. There are three things that I desire, and with those I finish. The first thing that I desire is that I, as Matthews Kalola Mwalw'a, now you know my names, that I would be filled with the Spirit. That I would be controlled by the Spirit of God, that I would resonate with God. Secondly, I desire that I would hear God. You know, it's okay to hear the voice of Nzonzi when he calls me about the fundraising. It's okay when I hear Mr. Ndambuki on the human resource. It's okay when Mr. Mwell calls regarding the technicalities in the building, but I want to hear the voice of God. I want to hear God. Because when God speaks to you, you are left with no doubt about the clarity of the issues at hand. When God speaks, you know God has spoken. When God speaks, there is no confusion. There was a time in this country, the Lord was doing great things and the Spirit of God was moving, and there was a charismatic movement, and the Spirit of God was moving in our high schools, in our universities, and there was a revival. And for some of you, got saved actually during that time. In the high schools, you will remember the Kenya Student Christian Fellowship, and some of you remember Focus, and they still exist and they're doing their work. But there was a special move of the Holy Spirit in those days. Then young people would be saved, and they would, and you could see they are genuinely saved. And then there were those who went overboard. Some guys were just drunk instead of being controlled. So a guy would go and grab a young lady at the university in Bwa and say, the Holy Spirit told me last night that you are mine. And the young lady is like, wait a minute, so he told you that I am yours? Wow. I mean, doesn't he give me time for courting and for thinking? And so us pastors, you know, and I was just a young pastor, I remember those days, and I remember telling the young people, okay, well, let's do this. Let's think through this. Do you remember when Mary was about to give birth to Jesus before she conceived? Remember what the angels told her? Gabriel comes and tells her, you know, Oh, Hail Mary, you are blessed of all the ladies in Bethlehem. You are highly exalted. And then she says, well, wait a minute. I am a virgin. How can this be? And the angel says, don't worry. God has already fixed that. This is the work of the Holy Spirit. Well, a few months later, Joseph, who was betrothed. Now, betrothing is like in our African traditions where the parents of the boy and the girl have all agreed and they have done all the transactions in the olden days in the Kamba. They would, that once the last event is done, you are committed. That's your wife. And so what the Kamba men used to do is to waylay the lady. She goes to the river to get water and never comes home. Now, Gerard, I'm not asking you to do that. But that it means that they were betrothed. It was legal. So Joseph, knowing that it was now legal, this was my wife. And then he hears that she is pregnant. So he decided, the Bible says, to leave her quietly. The angel, the same angel, comes to him and he says, Joseph, what you're thinking is not right. There's a work of God that is going on. Continue as usual. Take Mary as your wife. Don't worry about what's happening. It is a divine arrangement. And he says he woke up from his sleep and after this vision, and Jesus was born. If it is good, if it is divine, both of you will hear the voice of God. The church today is being taken for a ride. Those people who are selling us nunua kifuagio, buy this broom to sweep all your problems away. Buy these stones which killed Goliath. I desire to hear the voice of God. So that when it is God who has spoken, it is clear, there are no arguments, I know God has spoken. Like I have told you many times, that I am 100% plus sure that I am here by God's design. That he brought me here. Yesterday I had the privilege of being in the 20th year anniversary of a group called Sing Africa, which gave birth to Afleo. And Sing Africa was born in my office when I was senior chaplain at Daystar University. And they invited me and said, we have 20 years celebration. And I was able to share with them just very briefly. Saying, you know, one of the things that amazes me is that when God speaks, it happens. 20 years ago. And if you have never been to a Afleo, you don't know what you're missing. A whole night of praise and worship like never before. It was actually through a Afleo where God shocked me. You know, God has a way of shocking you. Miles Monroe was our guest speaker that night. And the leadership says, you know, you are our father. You started this thing. Please come and welcome him. And so we were there talking, had tea, and then later we went on stage and I welcomed him. It was live, those of you who would remember. And I remember him giving me such a hug and a squeeze. I had no idea that he was actually saying, brother, that's the last time. Because soon after that, he and his wife and members of his ministry crashed while he was going to his home village island. And he went to be with the Lord. Miles Monroe was one of those men whom the world will remember for saying, the grave is the richest place. The grave is the richest place, because there lies would have been doctor, but he never picked up himself to become a doctor. There lies would have been, but he never listened to the voice of God to become the evangelist or the engineer or the lawyer that he was meant to be. There lies would have been. The richest place is the grave. There lies a man who had money but didn't give it to the needy, left the money to be squandered and to be fought over by people who didn't work for it. The grave is the richest place because people don't hear God. But the last thing that I long for in my life, yes, I do. I don't want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. I want to hear God. But the last thing that I long for in my life, and this is my prayer for you also, is that I will be able to speak the Word of God with clarity and authoritatively, boldly, to speak this Word. This is the answer. This is the answer. Come next year, we will be speaking to you about politics. We will be speaking to you about election. You have nothing to fear. You have nothing to fear. Just like the Americans have nothing to fear, because the Word of God remains the same. Politicians will change, but the Word of God doesn't change. And I long for a time when this becomes real in every believer's life in this country. The Word of God does not change. You fight, you shed blood, you kill, and the people you are killing for don't care. Politics come and they go. When you remain, you wonder, why? Why did I do this? And then you go crazy, and all kinds of things follow you. Curses, because you don't shed a man's blood, and God leaves you alone. Unless you repent. It is only the Word of God. And I want to teach this Word. In the days of my life, before the trumpet of the Lord sounds. And I want to do it clearly. I want to do it with authority and power. I want to do it boldly. I want to do it kindly, of course. So that it doesn't matter whether it is the governor or the senator or the president or anybody else who is hearing my voice, they hear the same thing because it is the Word of God. That's what we need in this country. And I pray that it will be true, that you will speak it in your office, that you will speak it in the marketplace, that you will release this Word in your shop, that you will release this Word in your family, because this Word is transformative. This Word will bring change to all of us. After they prayed, God acted. And so I ask that when we come to you, we will be coming to you, and we will be asking you to join us and to pray. We're going to spend time praying. We'll be praying here in the congregation. We will be praying in other portions. Come, join us. Because after they prayed, then the place shook. That's the only way we are going to shake this country. It's after we pray. Not before. Let me ask you to be on your feet. Let me ask you to do something and do it with your neighbor. Just hold your neighbor and just tell your neighbor, after we pray, brother or sister, after we pray, just wait to see what God is going to do. Just tell them, after we pray, God is going to do something. Amen. Can you pray for your neighbor? Just hold them and just pray for them. And just say a little prayer for them. Just ask God that he would remove obstacles that stand in their way so that they are unable to pray. Would you just pray for that neighbor? Ask God to do his miracles. Would you just pray for that neighbor and tell God, God, I ask that this neighbor of mine will be shaken and those things that are loose would fall away. Things that are not where they're supposed to be. These things would be shaken so that the presence of God would remain in our lives. Father, we thank you for hearing our prayers, and we pray that after we engage the heart of God, we will see the results. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. We'll